in the industry panel, we have four eminent people, which we started with Professor Sadagopan, who is the director of IIIT Bangalore. And we have TNC Vengatraman. Yes, sir. TNC Vengatraman, who is a Microsoft regional director. And Professor Dr. A. Rajendran, who is a Lifecare Photo Labs Private Limited. And we have Mr. Shashikumar Gendam, who is a managing director of Cellcom Industry. So we welcome all the panelists for the industry. So I think Kalam sir's dream, I think India should be like a self-reliance in all the industry sector. It's not only like an automobile or electronics or chemical. So he wanted everything to be initiated in made in India. And it should increase our GDP, also give you lots of employment opportunity. So with that, I think I welcome all the panelists here for our webinar conference, India Beyond Vision 2020, which is challenges and opportunity. So I welcome the first panelist, Professor Sadagopan, sir. To brief him, he's a director of IIIT Bangalore, is a graduate of Madras University, India, and Prudhoe University, USA. He taught for more than 25 years of at IIT Kanpur, IIM Bangalore, IIT Madras, and IIIT Bangalore, in addition to short teaching assignment of Rootrax, USA, and IIT Bangkok. He has widely research interests that include operation research, multi-criteria optimization, decision theory, simulations, enterprises, computing, program languages, database, multimedia, and e-governance. He has authored several books, chapters, and paper. He also fellow of IEEE UK, Computer Society of India. He is a senior manager of IEEE ACM and AIS. Professor Sadagopan consults widely across different industry segments, auto, manufacturing, banking, IT, and social sectors, and gives lectures extensively at corporates, industry events, and universities in North America, South America, Europe, Middle East, Asia, Australia, New Zealand, in all aspects of IT. So I welcome our Professor Sadagopan for this eminent panelist. Sir, the session is with you. Please go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you for your kind introduction and a special privilege to be amidst an amazing set of panelists and to be part of a foundation which carries the name of Dr. Kalam, a person whom we all revere. It's a privilege. And okay, thank you. Okay. I would be very brief. What I thought was that I would just touch upon one point. What possibly COVID-19 can teach all of us. Just on the 1st of May, the chairman of Microsoft, Mr. Satya Nadella, he made a very interesting statement. He said, we are moving into a world of remote everything. Let me repeat, a world of remote everything. And looking back, I think in the last 52 days, many of us in places like IIITs. So what we have found is that practically we are able to do everything without really significant reduction in quality. We struggled a bit between March 15th to April 1st. We tried several platforms, we tried several experiments, etc. It took a while, but from April 1st to today, for 6 weeks, every class was delivered practically without any glitch. And then as a head of institute, I had never stepped out of my apartment, and all the things of the institute were able to do completely electronically. I'm not saying that this is necessarily the best or this is possible everywhere. Being only an IT institute, because we teach only computer science, so it has become much easier. And we are a much smaller school, so this is not necessarily scalable. But you actually realize that most of the banks have been performing fairly well. And the big baskets of the world could actually deliver milk to fruits, to vegetables every day without too much of a glitch. So what it shows is that a significant amount of things are possible to be done remotely. Okay? I'm not saying we should just for the heck of it, try to do everything remotely. That's not the point. The point is that a significant amount of things can be done remotely. That means we should ask the simple question, particularly for a country like India, because we have some serious problems. We have a phenomenal amount of urbanization, which forces lots of people to come and ghetto into the cities, whether it is Mumbai or Bangalore or Chennai, with very poor living conditions. And because there are no jobs in the rural area, they are forced to come here. And in addition, because of relative affluence, so we also have lots of us driving the cars, and we don't even give space for these people to walk or bike or a cycle. So there is over urbanization, too much of pollution, and of course the big problem which has become fashionable in Bangalore. Everybody talks about the traffic problems, except in the last 6 weeks. Okay, so if Dr. Kalam were around, I was just thinking, if I could have a nice conversation with him, he would probably feel happy, because he was always talking of this Pura notion, right? Providing urban amenities in rural areas. Imagine that if 30% of the population of Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad quietly moves out to smaller towns. So first of all, the traffic problem will just disappear. And second thing is, we will possibly have enormous amount of money left, which can be invested. See, to make a flyover in Bangalore costs hundreds, if not thousands of crores. 1100 crores was the cost of one flyover that got shot down. So maybe we could do much more of investment in the smaller towns and make life far more livable. And there is no reason why everybody has to be in these big cities. And I was very happy to see our CEO of TCS, Rajesh, talking of not more than 25% of the people have to come to office every day. And he is thinking that they had a plan of taking it by 2025. They are now thinking of doing it even earlier. So if just the IT industry, which employs about 4.5-5 million people, if they can start and several other people can start, if we can release that huge real estate, imagine that these big six IT companies have 120 huge campuses. If they can release 100 campuses, we can have 100 first-rate world-class hospitals, right? And if people can actually work from smaller towns, obviously we have to invest in social infrastructure. We have to have, I think the youngsters do want malls and cinema halls, and maybe the oldies want hospitals and temples. We may have to build all of them. But all of them are much lower cost, okay? And I remember that in the early days of TCS, when a lot many students did not get a chance to, employees after the beings to our students, did not get a chance to go to America, TCS actually had a special allowance for those who could not go to America. It is called India allowance. See, this country, we used to have what is called city compensatory allowance. So I have a crazy idea. Imagine that if everybody is told that your salary will double if you move away from Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, and Delhi, and Pune, and Bombay, I'm sure there will be at least some people who are willing to go. And can we create a new Quit India movement? Instead of Quit India, now we have Quit Chennai, Quit Bangalore, Quit Hyderabad. I'm taking southern towns because I'm more familiar with that. And if each state can take 100 towns and significantly improve the infrastructure, probably with the less money than what they have to do in Bangalore or Hyderabad or Chennai. And things like walking and cycling are just not possible, but encouraged by design from day one, we would have probably solved many problems. First, and you see, pollution is a two-level problem, right? One is the pollution which causes problem. Second thing is pollution leads to a lot of health problems. We spend much more money addressing that health. So if only we could possibly leverage and repurpose the investments in the right way, possibly we would probably achieve something. Something like this, we would not have thought about it, because, you know, things like remote working, you know, many of us have been doing it in some sense. Possibly people would say that, look, you know, it works for you, but it cannot work for everybody. But the fact is that so many people have been able to work without any significant degradation. And, you know, most institutes are able to deliver reasonably first-rate education. Okay, I'm not saying that, so by no means, stretch of imagination, I am forcing this blindly to everybody. But wherever possible, maybe 60, 70, 80% of the time, if we can do it, this would probably, COVID-19 would have given us a new opportunity. This is much more needed in India, because our urbanization is much higher. Second thing is, our urbanization also means significant quality reduction for a large number of people, which is not true of many countries. And we are still in the growing phase, and maybe we will create more jobs in a uniform way across the country. and people are already talking of getting manufacturing to this country. Obviously, manufacturing, if it moves away from the main city, it will be good for us. So this is something which I thought that I would leave it for thought for discussion. And I also want the youngsters to kind of take a look at it. I still remember when Mr. Asim Premji made a decision of moving 250 people, this must be about 15, 18 years back, from Bangalore to Mysore. Within 2 hours, he got all the resignation letters. And he actually had to take them back and drop the idea of moving to Mysore. I think sometimes I want the youngsters also to not think only of Bangalore, Hyderabad, and Chennai. They should probably discover that smaller towns can actually give great life for them. And now that connectivity being there, so they can always reach these big cities. So I think it is a thought process which they have to set in. They should accept that we don't want necessarily to insist on Bangalore and Hyderabad and Chennai. And if companies, and I'm sure all of us professors, if we could also kind of influence the students, together we would have done something good for the country. Okay, crazy thought. And the only thing I would say is, this is my understanding of Pura, of Dr. Kalam. I had long discussions with him. He was my good friend. He was so kind to me on so many occasions. So I thought that I will post this. And a special thanks to Sheikh, because he is a person who made me to come here. Okay, so thank you, Sheikh. And thank you all, esteemed panelists. I am open for questions from the panelists or from the other people who are listening. And thanks for listening. Thank you.